be interesting for anyone who, like me, might have bought all their Bitcoin at the top of the market and need some positive news. So our next speaker is Fred Antunes, who is from the Portuguese Blockchain and Cryptocurrencies Association. And Fred is going to talk to us about blockchain and specifically why decentralization is important. So please welcome to the stage, Fred.
Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for being here. And it's a pleasure for me, the first time to be here at the Lending Festival in Lisbon, my hometown. And you have no idea how Lisbon grown up in the last 10 years, you know. It's just pretty much amazing with how many new faces, how many new jobs, how many new careers we have improved in the last 10 years. But when we speak about blockchain, I know that it is like the sexiest and trendiest word and one of the biggest buzzwords that you heard in the last year. But for the good of the whole community, Bitcoin price went down and, you know, the trend started to cool down a bit, which was, in fact, in my personal opinion, just great. Why am I talking about Bitcoin when I speak about blockchain? Because both things, in my mind, exist exactly in the same place, exactly in a very single moment, and we cannot put them apart. Yes, they are slightly different because one is the framework and the database, and another one is the product. And this talk is all about the product. So what we can build with blockchain and why decentralization matters when we approach a new product using blockchain technology. Every single person that has some interest around distributed ledger technologies or distributed databases have heard about blockchain. But when we fall in love with the blockchain world, one of the most important things is to study and evaluate the biggest and the most successful use case of that technology in the world, and the most successful use case for the ones who like it and for the ones who hate it is Bitcoin. Gladly, that Bitcoin went to $2,000, to $20,000, and I'm happy once again that it went down, so a lot of people just moved away to clean a bit the field, and then the price seems that it's going up again. But what exactly is the power of blockchain and why so many people just spoke about it, and a lot of conferences, festivals, you know, events, meetups. In London, we have meetups every day about blockchain, about a lot of processes that we can use. In 1998, I was born in 1982. The subject about distributed ledgers and the subject about blockchain started a bit before I was born, in the age of 70s, when a group of people started to think not only in a technological way, but also in a philosophical and political way about what could we do with technology to improve mankind's society in exactly the most important things that is ruling us all, the political, the government, and the financial system. So in 1998, Nick Szabo published the first really conceptual idea about what coded and programmed money could be for the cyberspace, and that was called Bitgold. 10 years after, Satoshi Nakamoto improved the protocol and the whole smart contract, in fact, and published the Bitcoin protocol. What are we talking about, and what kind of game changer do we have here exactly? The most important one is to change the paradigm that we don't need exactly in a cyberspace to touch exactly the assets that we own and that we give value to that assets. So basically, in 2008, we created a new type of asset, which is called digital asset. That digital asset would need to be different in two main approaches. The first one, to not be controlled by the same people who was controlled controlling the printed money that created the bankrupt of Lehman Brothers in 2008 exactly in the United States of America and created a huge crisis to Europe and more or less around the world. So the first approach was, we don't need these people involved, we need to propose a new protocol. And how can we do this? Decentralizing the protocol. So basically, the database, when it's decentralized and not controlled by 10 persons all over the world, gives us the power to get two very important things. The first one, we reduce the corruption level because we need more people to validate the data that we register in that database. And the second one, we create a very powerful tool when we need to audit that process. So somehow Bitcoin was used in a very wrong way for 2-3 years in the United States, deep web, with all the things that you have heard about. But more or less in 2014, Vitalik Buterin has published a new protocol called Ethereum. So let's call it the second blockchain generation. So the first one, Bitcoin, very simple, just for digital money, digital asset, nothing more. And Vitalik published Ethereum, and in Ethereum, it created a framework where you can code and deploy your own smart contracts, and you can create your own digital assets. And what kind of process are we talking about when we create new digital assets? Basically, we have the chance and the opportunity to do one process called tokenization. Tokenization is the moment that you just create your own digital assets and you monetize what you have as an asset in your company. I give you two simple examples. Besides being part of the Portuguese Blockchain Association, I'm also CEO of Real Fever. You can download the app. Real Fever is a fantasy sports app with 250,000 users at the moment, 80,000 here in Portugal, and some achievements. But we have a monetization problem in Real Fever, which is we have a lot of users, a lot of happy users, but the company does not make that much money. So we have a wonderful product with 2 million downloads in App Store and Play Store, 2 million downloads with 4.5 average reviews in the application, but we don't have that much money and we need investment every single year, you know, to keep the company up. So what kind of procedure are we going to use to tokenize Real Fever and implement a new level of gamification? Probably some of you play some mobile games, and when you play some mobile games, you have a point system or you have an internal money system. I've played World of Warcraft for a few years in an hardcore mode, and in World of Warcraft, basically, our gold was everything inside the game. So we were always making business every single day with World of Warcraft back to 2005. And nowadays, when you create an app and you design a new product, you have that points. But that points, by default, you cannot convert them back to fiat, euro, dollar, Swiss francs, yuans, whatever. And you create a microeconomy inside the game, but that economy is pure virtual. What the tokenization process allows you to do is to create a second layer where that virtual money gets connected with something that a community of people can use to trade value and to use it in a different physical marketplace that is not only inside your game or inside your product. And then you ask me, okay, this is a bit confusing. I would need to see how it works and everything. First use case, very successful one, and PewDiePie is already on board, and a few more well-successful YouTubers. Please check DLive platform, because DLive platform is a decentralized YouTube where the money does not go only for Google. The money is distributed to the whole players and users who produce content and who see content. So when you work in a tokenization program, you should also think that you can achieve a monetization program for your company and for your product, but also the money should be distributed for everybody. And that's why decentralization matters. Probably in the last 2 weeks, a few of the hype again that is rising again came with Libra. Facebook is in the business, basically. And when you heard about crypto economy, you know, it's like, okay, Bitcoin was really a scam, a bubble, something that will disappear somehow in the next years. It's just a bunch of people. It was an idea of cypherpunks, you know, but it's just a scam for deep web, whatever. But when you have DLive with PewDiePie moving there, and when you have Facebook being on board with a consortium with Uber, with the Portuguese unicorn Farfetch, with Visa, MasterCard, and a few of others, big high-tech companies and fintech companies also, then you say, okay, is this good or bad for the whole ecosystem and for crypto economy? For me, it's very, very simple. Mark Zuckerberg is about to create the first worldwide successful digital state in the world. And something that you should all think about is, what is really a digital state, you know? To be a state, to be a country, or a digital country, whatever you want to call it, Zuckerberg will need three things. He needs citizens. We are all citizens already. He needs an army, but in fact, in cyberspace, we don't speak about an army. We speak about zeros and ones. And he needs a currency that everybody can use in the digital world. So Libra is not exactly against Bitcoin or a direct concurrent of Bitcoin. Libra is more or less another successful use case of a blockchain. But it has a dramatic and huge problem from my perspective. And why? Because it's not decentralized. So basically, Facebook is going to replace somehow the central government and the central banks, of course, but centralizing again. And our lives, as a product for Facebook, we will remain absolutely dominated in the end by one single person or a group of persons, Mark Zuckerberg and the whole others who are part of the consortium. So if you ask me, I'm not against Libra. I'm not against the Facebook approach. It's great because for mass adoption, it will create a big hype around crypto and blockchain once again. But it's not the best because we will always be products instead of shareholders of what we do every single day. So why decentralizing the projects and why decentralization matters? Because it helps us directly to not be only a product, but to be part of the project. I could give you multiple references about decentralized projects, but two ones that we should discuss, not using blockchain technology, but using decentralization in society in the overall. One of them that is a huge use case is here in Lisbon. Lisbon in 2009, 2010, 2011, there was a huge crisis and our employment rate was like 26%. So a lot of people was unemployed. And two decentralized approaches moved to Lisbon and created two simple ideas. First one, I have one house, what can I do with that? You know, how can I monetize my house? And I was a couch surfer for like 5 years of my life. My mom and my dad never gave me that much money to travel because my mother was always wanting me next to her. So for me to travel was very complicated. It was when I was like 18, 20, 21. And couch surfing was really a good approach. You know, you could just move around house and house and house and just a couch or a bed to sleep but just really in a friendly approach sharing that. And a decentralized approach came and said, we don't need a hotel to monetize a house or a bed and breakfast place. So basically, Airbnb was absolutely successful here in Lisbon because created multiple jobs for people who was an employer and gave the opportunity to that person to develop their own business in a very entrepreneur way. The second one, and even more controversial one, was Uber. So basically, I have a car. I don't want just to ask for a ride. I want to monetize my car and my time. How can I do it? So I don't need a specific central place where I will get a taxi, but I will just use my own car. And there is a platform that connects, you know, the customer, the client with the provider, and connecting them, we have like not the directly peer-to-peer connection. I know that the people who is really deep inside the crypto world will not let me say that it is a peer-to-peer connection. But anyways, it is way better than to have a central authority collecting money and tax from that. So just to finish my approach, when you think about tokenization, decentralization, immutability, transparency, and your ability to audit a process, when you develop that product, you should think about blockchain not as a product, but as a governance framework that will help you to develop your product. One of another examples that we have here in Portugal and we are currently developing is the first worldwide crypto village here in Portugal, like 200 kilometers away from Lisbon. And in crypto village, we are using blockchain technology, EOS. I'm a big fan of EOS, not doing any advertising, but EOS for coders and developers is something that you should look at it more than Ethereum. I know that Ethereum is very famous and a lot of people is deploying smart contracts in Ethereum, but EOS has a lot of potential, especially because transactions per second are higher, and second because the fees are almost zero, so the blockchain is working a bit better. But with blockchain, we can create a governance model where we decentralize the people in that town. So with that approach, every single person can contribute to the villa, to the village, by themselves, share the economy, and do trade in a peer-to-peer approach. And it's important to explain one very complex approach. How many of you already work with crypto, smart contracts, you know, stuff like that? Okay, very few. So when I speak about decentralized autonomous organization, this is a bit even more complex. But decentralized autonomous organization, or a DAO, is a place where we don't need specifically a state saying the rules, and we just deploy the law of that place in a smart contract, and the whole blockchain governates the rules that we decide to have in that place. We don't have already a legal framework for that in Portugal. From my knowledge, not even in any place of the world. But in the future, law can be and can stay and can be programmed inside a blockchain through a smart contract deployment. And one of the most impressive things that we have the privilege to be alive right now is because when we see Facebook, decentralized autonomous organizations, and let's wait to see what Jeff Bezos and Amazon and Google will do, because they will need to do something. But to have the privilege to be alive right now and to see what's going on and how the Federal Reserve of the United States of America, how Russians, how Chinese will play with this grown-up digital world, it's really, really, really funny to see, to be part of it, and to, you know, to just do my little piece of contribution to remove the power from someone who is always somehow corrupted, to give it to a machine that at least is not permanently tempted to steal the money from everybody somehow. So if you ask me in the end why decentralization matters, because I prefer personally to have a computer leading me than to have a group of people who is not protecting my daughter in the future. You know. Thank you very much. Any question? I still have time. Questions. If you have any question, sure. Yes, please.
Hello, thanks for your talk. I'm also like, I've been in cryptocurrencies 2016, and I have actually three questions. One thing that I realized, like at the beginning, I was just an investor and then I actually got involved with blockchain. Uh-huh. And one thing that I realized about decentralized blockchains is they're not very scalable. There's a lot of problems in it. Mm-hmm. My first question is, what do you think decentralized blockchain platforms should do to be more scalable? Mm-hmm. And second of all, this is for the investor standpoint. What do you think are the five top cryptocurrencies to invest at this point?
Okay, about the first question is very important, and sometimes there is a lot of misinformation and fake news about this. If you have a decentralized blockchain, your cybersecurity is higher, but it's slower. If you want to be faster, you will not have that much security, and you will have a faster database to perform your data. So my answer to the people that I work with every day is always, I don't care about speed at the moment. What I care is about test the best product with the speed we currently have without centralizing the database. So if you decide to centralize the database, you should not call it blockchain. Because for me, I'm sorry for the people who is against me, I understand, but a private blockchain, you should not use the word blockchain. Use DLT, distributed ledger technology. The thing is, it's not very sexy to say, I'm doing a DLT project. You know, it's way better to say, I'm doing a blockchain project. You know, so if you go private, use a DLT, or eventually a cloud computing database, which is faster, safe, secure, everything, and you don't need a blockchain, you know? So blockchain is a really specific thing that you cannot use for everything. So you should try out what is better to your project and to your product and then implement it. For me, every single monetization protocol, blockchain is an immediately framework solution to that product. But I see a lot of other things, you know, we need time. About the second one, it would not be that great for me to give you any kind of financial advice, but I can share with you my personal approach. I started to mine Bitcoin almost in the beginning. I have my first wallet is in the 12,500 and something block of the Bitcoin blockchain. So I'm really here from the beginning. I can tell that I did not sell anything at 20,000. I did not sell anything at 11,000, and I will not sell anything in the next 10 years. And I tell you why. I'm a very religious guy, you know. And if you sell it just to get euros, it's just, you know, it's not the point, the philosophical concept of what we are trying to change in the society, you know. So if you are just looking for euros, you will not have a deal or a good talk. But if you are, in the long run, changing the paradigm of the society, yes, that then you count me in. Any other question? Yes, please. Maybe 100,000, it will be my exit point, if my daughter decides.
Speaking of decentralization, what like, if something unexpected happens, like if I have digital assets and mm-hmm. I die or something happens, who decides, or are they lost, or who decides where they get to?
Great question. And basically what he's asking is, blockchain and a digital asset is registered with a system of private keys and public keys, okay? And what happens if I lose my private key? Who covers my digital assets? For, let's give an example, I have my digital assets in a wallet, I lose my private key or I die, here's your question, who takes control of it? Well, at the moment, no one. So the reality at the moment is, if you lose your private key, you lose your assets. Or if you send your assets to a wrong wallet, nobody will bring you back your assets. So that are the rules. So when you want a decentralized and a free thinking society, there is no one to protect you, okay? So I'm not saying that it is the best approach, but it's the approach that I feel comfortable, but it's not perfect. There is never a perfect solution. Answering your question, custody is one of the solutions and one of the new roles that banks will have in the future. So someone will need in the future to do the custody of your digital assets. Because I give you an example. You said you have digital assets. Okay. Let's say you have one Bitcoin and you hold it with you on your mobile phone every day. One Bitcoin is like 12,000, 11,000 is not that much money. But if you say you have 1,000 Bitcoin, it's a lot of money. And if you have 50,000 Bitcoin, it's a lot of millions. You cannot walk around with you every day on your mobile phone. Or eventually, if someone knows that you hold it at home in a paper wallet or in a nano ledger or in a treasure or whatever, I just get, you know, a bunch of Italians, you know, with some machine guns or Russians. I go to your house, I point a gun at your head, and you will give your private key. This was the problem that Satoshi Nakamoto never thought about it, okay? It's like, you own your keys, you own your money, but, and if there is someone around you, new role for the banks, custody of your digital assets, or one project that is being developed here in Lisbon called it Treasury. Treasury basically is a smart contract where your private key is splitted in four different pieces and put it in different wallets with different players that you will give access. And that four persons, it can include your wife, it can include your mother, your father, someone you trust, your lawyer with the power of attorney to represent you. So you decide four persons that when you die, your dead certificate, yes, will trigger the activation of the smart contract. And in that smart contract, that four persons will need to appear and have access to the original private key. It's a bit more complex, but yes, banks will do digital assets custody in the future. At the moment in Mauritius and Singapore, there is already licenses for that. And somehow, near the future, in Portugal and in Europe, it will happen the same. Any other question? Just one last, I guess.
First of all, thank you for your insights. Yes. I learned a lot here. I think, generally, technology is just a means to get to the product purpose. Mm-hmm. And what I'm really wondering about is, what's your view with the purpose of a currency? I mean, right now it would simply not be practical to be paid your salary in bitcoins. Mm-hmm. That would be highly volatile. I mean, how would you get along with that? Do you think that is going to change once Bitcoin would technically become the norm currency? Like, would this volatility?
Sometimes the correct answer is just to study history. And in the creation of United States of America, there was a moment that there was 36,000 different coins working around. And then the government started to, you know, put them apart and apart and apart until dollar started to control everything. In the old British Empire and in old England, let's say, there was like 25 different coins for different kingdoms, you know? So different currencies for people to trade with value with each other, history has a lot of them. But just because we had crisis and our mind was set up to, we need to trust only these guys, otherwise everybody dies, was really the huge success of the mother banks, you know? But if you are a free thinker and you see the things by yourself, you just realize that Libra will be a successful use case, because once everybody in this room accepts Libra to pay something, it's done. So the future will be here somehow, you know, with a lot of fights, with a lot of turbulence, of course, but Libra and any other cryptocurrency, as long as it is accepted, it will be functional in the future. But we'll need 10 more years, so it's a long run. It's not tomorrow, and people want it tomorrow, you know. So you want to buy 10,000, one Bitcoin today, and you want that the value rises up in the next 6 months. And I'm glad that that does not happen. Okay?
Okay, that's all we got time for, unfortunately. But I'm sure you'll be happy to answer any questions that people will have afterwards. Come and grab Fred afterwards.
Guys, thank you very much. On my LinkedIn, Fred Antunes, please get in touch. If any of you wants to be a coder, blockchain developer, whatever, we are hiring as much people as we can. We have some money to improve your career somehow here in Lisbon and in Tel Aviv in Israel. So if you are in the mood, just drop me a message, and for your career, something that we can improve, okay? Thank you very much for your time.